Welcome to today's joint webinar with NXP and Toradex about simplifying your product development with Verdin i.MX8M Mini and Nano system on modules. My name is Daniel Lang and I'm the Chief Marketing Officer of Toradex. Before diving into the webinar, let me cover a few organizational points. Please use the chat if you have any technical issues, for example, if you can't hear us anymore and want to let us know. At the end, we will do an interactive question and answer session with our experts. You can type your question into the question field of the webinar tool at any time, and we will pick them up at the end. The webinar will be recorded and made available for on-demand viewing later. With that, let's get started. First, let me introduce you to the presenters. Amanda McGregor is the Global Product Marketing and Application Manager from NXP, and she will give you an overview about the i.MX8M Mini and Nano application processors. Later, Simon Horvath, the Technical Product Manager from Toradex, will show you how Verdin simplifies your development. But we will start with a brief overview about who Toradex is and what we do. So Toradex is focusing on making embedded computing easy to use, so you can get simple access to the latest technology for your product development. We are doing this by providing a highly reliable ARM system on module, which includes software and support. We are also striving to offer the lowest cost of ownership to you. This means not just the module price, but also we are considering things like development effort, time to market, and long-term maintenance. We are proud of being able to have industry-leading support, including a very active community and a developer page with over 800 articles, which is updated daily. As you can see here on that map, we have offices around the world, and most of them have local support and warehouses. Here, a very brief overview of our product roadmap. So we have three SoM families. Inside these families, the modules are pin compatible. For example, you can actually upgrade from iMX6 to iMX7, iMX8 very seamlessly. We're also providing production quality software with these modules, but you will learn more about our offerings later in the webinar. I also like to give you a short overview about our focus application as we are optimizing our products and offerings for this application. So we're covering industrial automation, healthcare, test and measurement, retail ticketing, transportation, and smart city. Typical projects at our customers reaching from a few hundred to a few 10,000 products per year. And then Toradex itself has a few thousand active customers. As you can see in our product lineup, we're really, really liking NXP and working closely with them for many years. NXP is excellent in providing highly reliable application processors that are available for over 10 years. With that, let me hand over to Amanda from NXP.
Thank you, Daniel. Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for joining. Amanda McGregor here. I manage the i.MX applications processes, and I want to give you a bit of an overview into some of our latest products during this session today. So this topic webinar is focused a little bit more on some of our newer products we've released, the 8M Mini and the 8M Nano. But here I'd just like to just really point out that Toradex has been a real key partner for NXP over many, many years across our entire i.MX portfolio. So as you just saw on the previous slide, they do have many solutions available across our whole portfolio. So we look forward to continuing to work with them on our future i.MX products as well. Now I'd like to go into the specifics of the 8M Mini and the 8M Nano. On the next slide, we'll talk a little bit more about the 8M family. So this is our newest product family that is very focused on general purpose edge processing. It consists of four different products underneath the umbrella of the 8M family. They are all based on a quad-core A53 with a Cortex-M co-processor for heterogeneous multi-core computing. This is a standard architectural element across these products. We do have different capabilities on each of these different devices, whether we have a dedicated ML accelerator on our latest 8M Plus that was just recently announced. We have video capabilities. 3D GPU is standard across all of these products. A range of high-speed interfaces, we have audio support, and they are industrial and consumer products, so you'll see them be on our longevity program for 10 and 15 years. And we also offer industrial temperature range and industrial usage profiles on all of our products. So they are very similar look and feel from a peripheral standpoint, from a software enablement point of view, to our popular i.MX6 series, which we launched in 2012 and has been extremely successful over the years. And we actually see many customers looking to the 8M family as they want more capabilities, more core performance, the latest memories to be supported on some of our newer 8M products. One note here that the 8M Mini and the 8M Nano are pin-for-pin compatible. So that is a key part of our enablement at the low-mid range of this product family. To enable our customers to build some scalability into their platforms. But overall, the whole portfolio, there's software compatibility. Just a view into some of the target applications. This is by no means an exhaustive list, just meant to really kind of point out some of the key areas that we see our customers using our 8M products in today. Most of these are all where we have seen previous generation iMX6 customers use our products as well. The 8M Mini and the 8M Nano in particular are very well suited for more cost-sensitive designs that require high levels of processing, some multimedia capability and connectivity. So we see them in anything ranging from a headless device. It could be something that is more of a gateway type of product, or something that is taking in cameras to do some vision processing, some inventory management through handheld barcode scanning. That could be used in HMI applications where customers are working in factories, interacting with machines using large panels that require high graphics capability. Or they could be residential applications. So we have customers designing voice controlled light switches. We have thermostats. We have video doorbells. We even extend into the healthcare industry as well, whether it's some fitness equipment, more telemedicine type applications. So very, very broad scale product portfolio. Here we have a little bit more of a focus in on the 8M Mini and the 8M Nano key features. So first of all, let's talk about this power efficiency and scalable performance. So our products are built in 14 LPC FinFET. They are made in Austin. We use this technology to allow us to provide a faster level of performance, or higher level of performance, through faster core frequencies to give more available DMIPS to applications. But while really trying to be more prudent with power. So we're offering more performance with power efficiency. So that's enabled through the 14 LPC FinFET technology that we use. This is our standard for the 8M Mini, the 8M Nano. We have, in terms of scalability, we have multiple options for the number of cores that you can use in your design. So we have 1, 2, or 4 Cortex-A53 cores running at various speeds, depending on if you have an industrial part or a commercial part, or the 8M Mini or the 8M Nano. We provide a Cortex-M4 or a Cortex-M7 as part of our core architecture for both products. The 8M Mini has a Cortex-M4, the 8M Nano has the M7. And what this allows you to do is be able to run some real-time operations. You can do some low-power tasks where you are running a subset of functionality on the Cortex-M core and being able to keep the faster, more power-hungry A cores idle during this time to really control the efficiency of your platform. And we have a pin-compatible package between the two. So you can design once and then be able to choose which product you would use in a certain application. The second pillar, we have a very media-rich product across graphics, audio, and the UI that we can enable. So we have a 3D GPU on both products. That's really important when it comes to HMI and making sure that we're using a more efficient hardware system to drive more capabilities with the user interface. On the 8M Mini, we do have video encode and video decode. We have many customers taking advantage of that in terms of applications, whether it could be a pipeline, a remote pipeline monitor, taking in video feed and compressing it and sending it back to a central server for analysis. It could be a video doorbell. So there are certainly applications for the video element that would require a customer to scale up to an 8M Mini capability. They both support MIPI DSI, which are more cost-effective, lower resolution displays. The sweet spot for those is usually in the 720p to 1080p range. They have a MIPI camera input as well. So we support multiple camera types connected externally through our partners who offer different modules that can pair with these products. We have USB 2, we have 10100 gigabit Ethernet, and we have PCIe on the 8M Mini. These can be used, the PCIe can be used for connecting to Wi-Fi as an example. On the 8M Mini, for the 8M Nano, you could connect to Wi-Fi using the SDIO interface. And we do have some advanced audio capabilities on both of our products. Size and cost optimized system design. So we apply a very thoughtful process in our package and our hardware board design. We go through a process of co-design where we evaluate the ball map of the product and how that might impact the layout of the hardware board. And we go through multiple iterations where we're really looking for the most optimal position where we can provide the most functionality in the smallest package without transferring HDI board costs to you. We support multiple memory types, which gives you more flexibility with what you choose in your system, whether you're looking for lower density memory or higher performance, better power, such as LPDDR4. And we have our NXP supported software that goes along with our product as well. And as mentioned, we do have industrial capabilities in terms of junction temperature. We have qualification for industrial, which allows a 10-year continuous usage model. And we do have supply commitment as well for our commercial and industrial devices. Here we have an example of how an 8M Mini or a Nano could be used for a smart access control system and really just building out the key blocks that visually you can see how this part could be used. Here you have a HMI panel using MIPI DSI, or you could also have an LVDS panel that uses a MIPI DSI to LVDS bridge converter. This is driving the user interface using the 3D GPU with OpenGL ES support. The camera is a MIPI CSI taking in some vision, whether it could be for face recognition. In that case, face recognition could run on the Cortex-A53 cores. You have four of them, so depending on what else you're running in this system, there is some ability to do some basic face detection and recognition on this platform. The ARM Cortex-M in this case is doing some real-time control or low-power management. It could also be used to do some simple wake word detection, which creates even more power efficiency. We do have security across our whole portfolio. Those of you familiar with iMX6, we do have high assurance boot and all the crypto accelerators that you are familiar with from the iMX6 series. We've carried those over to the iMX8. And then we have a wide range of connectivity and memory interfaces here. So quick look at how this product can be used. Here we have more of a detailed block diagram. Red boxes are the differences between the 8M Mini and the 8M Nano. So these are the kind of key areas to focus in on. We do have the Cortex-M7 for the 8M Nano. It can run a little bit faster at 750 megahertz versus the Cortex-M4 running at 400 on the 8M Mini. So just gives a little bit more versatility with how you're using this second core. In terms of the multimedia, we do have a 3D GPU on the 8M Nano that can support OpenGL ES 3.1 and Vulkan, which is used for newer Android 10 and above. It also supports OpenCL, so there is some level of ML that can be applied to the 3D GPU because the OpenCL language allows you to direct commands to the GPU and use it as more of a general purpose GPU rather than just performing graphics tasks. The other key differences is the video. So the 8M Mini does have the video codecs for H.264 and H.265 decode and H.264 encode. And then there are some differences in the external memory width between the two, though they both support LPDDR4, DDR3L and DDR4. So, you know, key here is there are some differences. You can scale between the two, but we do have a compatibility guide that talks about the differences in a little bit more detail. But, you know, between the two, we have a very powerful portfolio that can help to address your application targets. And here is a list of the part numbers that we have at a high level, just showing that we do have different versions. We do have pin compatibility between the Mini and the Nano in the 14x14 millimeter package. But even within those products, we have different options, whether it's a four core, a two core, or a single core Cortex-A53. We have versions of the 8M Mini without the video codecs if you're looking to have more of the connectivity options of the 8M Mini, like the PCI Express, like the second USB, without packing in the video capability. And then for the 8M Nano, we can go down even lower. We have versions without the GPU. So if you're really not driving a graphical display in your product, the 8M Nano Light version could be a great target for your application because it does not provide the graphic hardware. So it can enable a little bit more of a cost-effective solution. Now, for more information on these products, we do have a plethora of information available on nxp.com. We have application notes. We have full product documentation. NXP provides excellent documentation on our website. We have a very strong community for Q&A. And then, of course, Toradex is our key NXP partner, has an entire site dedicated to all of the modules that they build out and a lot more information on their website. So thank you for your time. I hope this has given you a little bit of a look into the products. Just curious now, from what you've heard, based on some of the differences between the two products and where your application is heading, do you think the 8M Mini is a good fit? The 8M Nano? Both could work, neither? Or you don't know? Love to get some of your thoughts in real time here. So please select one of the options below. Okay, great. Good to see that you all, at least neither would not work. Neither would work is not an option. For the I don't know, so please go to those resources that we've listed out. You can reach out on the community. If you already have a sales contact or an FAE or a distributor, please reach out to them so we can help you decide if one of them might be a good fit for you. And now I'd like to hand it back over to Simon, who's going to more details on Toradex.
Hi, everyone. So in the upcoming part of the session, we will go through the key features of the Verdin family, the Verdin iMX8M Mini and Nano system of modules from Toradex. So Verdin is a recent addition to the portfolio of Toradex system of modules families. It is launched in 2020, just a few weeks ago, and it is featuring modern high-speed interfaces. It has a high pin count connector providing 260 pins. It is capable of being powered from both 3.3 and 5 volts. It has its IOs at 1.8 volts voltage level. It has a simple yet advanced power concept. It provides a TDP, a total dissipated power range of up to 5 watts. Its form factor is similar to the Colibri, but the surface, total surface area is a little bit smaller. It is also prepared for thermal solutions. Some additional highlights from the Verdin product family. As the other Toradex product families, Verdin is also pin compatible and scalable, which means upgrade and downgrade capabilities inside the Verdin family. So when you settle for a particular system or module, later you are able to choose a higher power or a lower power one, basically a different module. And from a pinout point of view, you can really upgrade and downgrade. Simple and low-cost carrier board design and enabling that is a key feature of Verdin. Verdin provides onboard Wi-Fi and Bluetooth connectivity. It's capable of advanced peripheral power management. It offers hardware-based security. And as other Toradex system on modules too, it is long-term available for 10 plus years. I would like to talk a little bit about the interfaces of the Verdin family. We have defined three simple interface categories: always compatible, reserved, and module specific, every Verdin module. These interfaces are basically present at each and every Verdin SoM. If you use these interfaces, you can be sure that in the future you can downgrade or upgrade to another Verdin module. Reserved pins have a dedicated function and are available on most Verdin modules. It is very highly likely that a Verdin SoM will have the reserved interfaces, but it can happen that one or two of these interfaces are missing. Even if they are not there, the pins are electrically still compatible, so upgrading and downgrading is possible. Module-specific pins provide access to special features of a certain SoC, and these are not guaranteed to be functionally and electrically compatible with other Verdin modules. So if you plan on using module-specific pins, you will need to keep it in mind that you can be limited in terms of upgrade and downgrade capabilities, and also electrical compatibility of pins is not guaranteed there. I would like to say a few words about the display interfaces of Verdin. The primary display interface is MIPI DSI, and the reason for that is that MIPI DSI is the dominant display interface on most of the SoCs the Verdin family is targeting. On the other hand, we provide reference implementations for DSI to HDMI, LVDS, and parallel adapters. So if you need any of those interfaces, you could still make it available easily. We provide schematics, layouts, bill of materials, and also 3D models for these reference designs. We will also feature a MIPI DSI display in the Toradex webshop. Verdin has also a secondary display interface. That's an HDMI interface, and it is located in the reserved pin category, meaning that it will be available on most Verdin SoMs, but not all of them. Here is an overview of the Verdin module interfaces. You see the three categories we've been discussing before. In the always compatible category, we have a gigabit Ethernet, we have two USB 2.0 ports, one being a host, another one being an OTG port. We have some low speed interfaces there, an I2C, an SPI, three UART ports, and we have some additional GPIOs here, also a PWM and an SDIO interface. In the reserved category, we have display and camera interfaces, the MIPI DSI and the MIPI CSI. We have an HDMI interface, which is, as said before, the secondary display interface of the Verdin family. We have an additional RGMII interface here. So on carrier boards, you will be able to provide a second Ethernet interface. We also have a USB 3.0 host here, PCI Express, CAN-FD, QSPI, additional I2C interfaces, two I2S interface for audio. We have some ADC channels here, additional PWMs, additional UART ports. And we also have a JTAG interface, which is a new addition. So in case of Verdin, the JTAG interface will be available on the module connector. In the module specific category, we have about 45 pins, which we could use for differential pairs and single-ended signals too. The high-speed interfaces on this slide are marked in green, and it gives you an idea about how many of these high-speed interfaces are available on Verdin family system of modules. As I said before, Verdin in terms of mechanical dimensions is similar to the Colibri form factor. It is a little bit smaller though. Verdin supports multiple mounting solutions, the first one being a fast and easy solution offered by the DDR4 SODIMM connector of the module. Basically, you insert the module, you press on it, and it clicks into place. This is very nice in development when you need to remove and reinstall modules frequently. The second solution is a rugged one. As you see it on the picture, the Verdin modules have two mounting holes, which you could use for additional fixation to make the installation shock and vibration proof. We are testing Verdin modules for vibration and shock resistance. The standards are listed here, and we will also make the test reports available for you. Verdin modules come in two different temperature ranges, or they support these two different temperature ranges. The first one is the standard from 0 to 70 degrees Celsius, and the other one is the industrial temperature range going from minus 40 to plus 85 degrees Celsius. I would like to spend a few words on the SODIMM DDR4 connector. Here we have listed the reasons, the most important reasons for us settling for this connector. So this connector offers mechanical tolerances and connecting modules to carrier boards manufactured to less demanding standards is easily possible without compromising the connections. So this contributes to more efficient and lower cost carrier board manufacturing and assembly too. With this connector, components can be placed under the module on the top surface of the carrier board PCB as shown in one of the graphics here. This allows you to save some space and come up with a smaller overall product in the end. The spring-loaded connectors of the edge connector absorb or dampen mechanical shocks and vibrations. So this connector has really great potential for ruggedization. It is well suited for industrial applications. As I said before, exchanging modules with this edge connector approach is very easy and supports development use cases pretty well. These connectors are widely available, and we have multiple trusted manufacturers and suppliers for these. Verdin supports a wide input voltage range, meaning you could also power it from 3.3 and also 5 volts. Actually, the absolute range is listed here on the slide. This is from 3.135 volts to 5.5 volts. Verdin IOs work at 1.8 volts voltage level. Verdin is battery ready. You could even power a Verdin module from a single cell battery. Verdin modules feature an extremely low power real-time clock on board, and Verdin modules support advanced peripheral power management, which means peripherals on the module are power gated, and this can be expanded to carrier boards too in an easy way. Verdin modules support the low power states of SoCs, so sleep, suspend, and Cortex-M only. Power states are also available, meaning that you could, for example, have the M cores running, taking care of real-time processing tasks, and then you would like to, for example, display a user interface, you could start the A cores, you could communicate between those two, and you could really tailor the application to the requirements, be it low power or real-time or functional safety related. Here, I would like to talk about the advantages of the 1.8 volts IO voltage level and give you a little insights into why did we choose this voltage level. We had a look at peripherals. They are widely available for this 1.8 volts voltage range. Overall, we could have lower power consumption using IOs at this voltage level. It is less likely that the IOs will become a source of electromagnetic interference, and it is more likely that the IO voltage level will match the IO voltage level of the SoC, which could mean cost savings and lower complexity for your designs. And last but not least, the 1.8 volts IO voltage level is future-proof. And with Verdin, we are planning for the upcoming 10-15 years, and it is very important for us that we make decisions that we could commit to on the long run too. Simple carrier board design is very important for us at Toradex. So we would like to do everything in our power to support you in designing simple, low-cost carrier boards. That means on Verdin, we have simple power supply requirements. We support direct breakout, which is basically an approach we take on the module connector, to be more specific with the pinout. We arrange pins in a way that it is really easy to break out module pins and route all the traces and the signals to the connectors. So thanks to direct breakout, you won't need to cross traces or traverse layers in order to reach the connectors or the peripherals on the carrier board. Simple PCB manufacturing and assembly technology is very important for us because that helps driving down the cost of custom carrier boards. We provide extensive documentation and design sources to get you started with Verdin. And also our industry-leading support is available for you if you have questions or if you face any issues during your design. So until now, I was talking about Verdin as a product family. And now I would like to spend a couple of slides and go into the details of the Verdin iMX8M Mini and Nano system of modules. So these modules, as said before, are based on NXP's iMX8M Mini and Nano system on chips. These provide up to four Cortex-A53 cores running at up to 1.8 GHz frequency, and also one M core. In case of the 8M Mini, that's a Cortex M4 core. For the 8M Nano, that's a Cortex M7 core. Verdin iMX8M Mini and Nano system of modules provide up to 2 GB of RAM and up to 16 GB of eMMC flash. We have dual band Wi-Fi on board and also support Bluetooth 5. In addition to those, we have CAN-FD, ADC, PCI Express, MIPI DSI, CSI, and a lot of other interfaces too. These modules are also available in an industrial temperature range, as I said before, between minus 40 and plus 85 degrees Celsius. Verdin iMX8M Mini and Nano system of modules will be available until at least 2030. On the next slide, we have a block diagram of the 8M Mini and Nano system of modules. So you see the most important peripherals here. Of course, this is a simplified diagram showing the main components, including the RAM, the flash. You see the ADC there. It's an interesting addition. We have a secure element, which is currently in experimental status. We also have EEPROMs on our system of modules. We use this to identify our products and to simplify coming up with an easy and nice out-of-the-box experience for our customers. You also see the low-power RTC, and we have an Ethernet PHY, we have the Wi-Fi Bluetooth module, and you see the CAN controllers too, in addition to all the interfaces which we've been discussing before. From a module interfaces point of view, the iMX8M Mini and Nano modules provide all of the always compatible interfaces, which you see on the leftmost column on the right side. So Gigabit Ethernet, USB 2.0 host and OTG, and all the interfaces which we've been discussing before. In the reserved category, all interfaces are available except for three, the HDMI, the RGMII, and the USB 3.0 host. It's important to mention that even though the HDMI in the reserved category is not available on these modules, we could still use the MIPI DSI interface to convert that to HDMI, and we also have an adapter available, and also reference designs to get you started with your own converters. On the RGMI, it is important to point out that what's missing on the iMX8M Mini and Nano modules, that's the secondary interface. So we still have a gigabit Ethernet interface in the always compatible class. These modules provide different interfaces in the module specific category, depending on stock keeping unit configuration, an additional SDIO interface, additional GPIOs, serial audio interface, and pulse density modulation interface, which you could use, for example, for microphones, are also available, in addition to card reader interface and NFC antenna, which are provided by the secure element, which is in experimental state. Here we have a poll, so feel free to provide your inputs there. And the question is, which of the following describes your area of focus best? Hardware development, software development, procurement, management, or maker? This question is particularly important for us because in the current webinar, we are mostly focusing on hardware, but software is a very important part of our activities. We are spending a lot of resources to provide a nice out-of-the-box software experience. So with that being said, I would like to talk a little bit about software. So our Torizon and Torizon Core offerings provide you fast time to market. Basically, Torizon is an easy-to-use industrial Linux software platform, and Torizon Core is the operating system serving as the basis of that platform. So Torizon provides you with a ready-to-use Linux distribution. It is open source, so you could avoid vendor lock-ins and you could migrate to a different Linux distribution relatively easily. Torizon supports simple updates. It's built-in, automated, grade, and over-the-air. These update capabilities are really flexible and useful. Torizon is secure. It provides frequent updates and accessible security features. It is also optimized for real-time operation. There is a modern continuous integration infrastructure behind Torizon and its services, and that contributes to be able to offer stable, verified, and tested images and services for our customers. We also have a vast ecosystem of partners available. Some of them provide operating system support, for example, for QNX or Android. Some others provide software engineering services or software products. We also have partners for hardware engineering services. There are carrier boards and peripherals available from these partners. This ecosystem really supports you achieving your goals, be it designing hardware or manufacturing it or developing custom applications for your solution. On the next slide, I would like to give an introduction into how could you get started with Verdin and the Verdin iMX8M Mini and Nano modules. At Toradex, we have two carrier boards available for Verdin. The first one is a development board, which is available now. It is a fully featured carrier board exposing all of the Verdin interfaces. Its physical dimensions are 250 by 200 millimeters. The other one is called Dahlia. It is limited availability right now. It offers the most common Verdin features and it really focuses on ease of use. It's a smaller carrier board having physical dimensions of 120 by 120 millimeters. We also have third-party carrier boards available. A few examples are listed here. For example, an industrial automation controller from Linear Computing, an IoT gateway, and HMI solution for Revolution Robotics. Verdin is also supported, will be supported very soon on the Geppetto platform from Gumsticks. On this slide, we provide some links which give an idea about really getting started with Verdin. We have detailed step-by-step getting started guides online, detailing unboxing and setup, installing operating system, and also beginning with development. I will open this link and we'll just show you how does it look like. So now we are on the developer website of Toradex, which is a very useful source of information. Here I will select a Verdin module. Then I will pick a carrier board. Let's say it's the Verdin development board for now. I will need to choose my target device operating system, which is Linux Torizon. And I will assume I'm coming from a Windows environment. So I did basically all the selections. I'm ready to start. And here, the next page gives an overview about how the process looks like, what kind of resources are available. So let's start from module one, which is unboxing and bring up. You see the different steps detailed on the right side. So I will just click start. Here I see some conventions first, which are defined in order to make sure that everyone is on the same page. And then we see the actual content on the next page. So here is an overview. There is an animated GIF showing you how to mount the module, which interfaces to connect in where. And we have then a block diagram showing the whole system. We have some dependencies defined here. And after that, we have a step-by-step guide guiding you through the steps of installation and setup. On the next page, we will begin installing an operating system. So basically, we will turn on the module. Then Toradex Easy Installer, which is a graphical tool for choosing and installing images, will show up. You will be able to pick one image there and you will be guided through the installation. Then step four here, for example, is showing the install screen of Torizon Core. And after we are done with that, we are already at basic use cases. We will open the Linux terminal there. We will issue some commands. And then later, we will dive into making our first steps with Torizon. We will start containers. We will create Docker files and so on. I just wanted to show you this to really give an idea about how easy it is to start working with Verdin and the iMX8M Mini and Nano modules. We also have a product page available for these products. I will also show you that one. So here you can find all related information. For example, I will click the technical details on our website, and this will redirect me to the developer website, which I mentioned before. And as you see here, we have multiple tabs. You can access data sheets, 3D models. You can have a look at carrier boards compatible with the Verdin iMX8M Mini and Nano modules. You also will see the revision history, and you can also have a look at known issues and erratas. Basically, this is a central source of information at your disposal. And with that being said, we arrived to the Q&A section. So please feel free to ask your questions here. And we will do our best to provide you with answers for those. In case we run out of time, because we have roughly 10 minutes remaining, we will get back to you and we will provide answers to those questions. So I'm looking at the first questions here. Can you run embedded AI machine learning? Does it support 5G connectivity? I guess this is on the Verdin module. Daniel, could you take this one?
Yes, also Amanda pointed out, you can do AI and ML. Also Toradex has actually an ecosystem. One of the partners you saw has a camera. So we work with industrial camera provider with Allied Vision, and we have a few more coming up. And then we also support the tools from NXP. And then we also have partners like Ozone, which provide additional frameworks to really optimize your AI networks or deep learning networks for embedded devices. So this is definitely something you can do. And as Amanda said, even there is some limited functionality of the GPU to offload some of the tasks and to the GPU. Does it support 5G connectivity? So there is no modem directly in the SoC, an application processor, or on the module, but it's very common application for our customer to add connectivity. So even our standard carrier board, you see Dahlia and the development board, they have mini PCIe cards, and they work with companies like MuBlox and other, which have modems, and then we even have a slot for an SIM card, if that's still required, or of course, newer modems sometimes use embedded SIMs to do that. So it's not on the module, but it's pretty straightforward to add that. In particular, 5G, I'm not aware that we tested anything with 5G or what's exactly available, but I assume it will be similar to 4G there.
Thank you, Daniel. The next one, so we have a hobbyist and a freelancer who try to buy some system on modules for learning and shifting from Raspberry Pi, which sounds very interesting. What he heard is that we do B2B business only, and he can't buy some unless he has a business case. Can you answer this one, Daniel?
Yes, Toradex is focused on B2B, but you can actually buy our modules just in the Toradex web shop, and there is no minimum order quantities or anything, so you should just be able to order them. The only time we have restriction if there is really limited supply, so maybe you tried our iMX8 Quad Max or the X product where we were in early access, and the products were very limited. Then we had, unfortunately, to filter a little bit. But in general, as soon as they're general available, you can just buy one and play around with that. And we see many people. Also, it's really easy to use. But really, the advantage is it's something easy to use, similar to Raspberry Pi, but then you also can take it in volume production. So you should be able to order that.
Thank you. Are these modules only set up to function at 1.8 volts logic level, or can they be configured to operate at 3.3 volts logic levels? So, as I mentioned before in the beginning of this section, Verdin really operates at 1.8 volts IO voltage level. So, that's something you can't change in configuration. Of course, there are some interfaces which are using a mixture of these voltage levels, but by design, Verdin really supports 1.8 volts. And then the next one, how does the upcoming iMX8M Plus compare? This is a very good question. We are looking into the iMX8M Plus. That's a very interesting system on chip. And as far as I know, it will feature an additional RGMI interface. So applications featuring dual Ethernet ports will be possible and feasible with that system on chip. It also will have a neural processing unit. So for AI applications, it will have significant advantages. And it really offers an interesting set of interfaces, and that's something we are looking into.
Of course, Amanda, if you'd like to add something with this SoC question.
No, I think that was a great response. And for more information on the 8M Plus, just from a feature standpoint, there is a fact sheet and a block diagram on nxp.com if you want to go and have a further look into what some of its features and capabilities are.
Thank you, Amanda. The next one, does Toradex plan to support the iMX8M Plus? That's also a very, very good question. And yes, we plan to support it. What Android versions are supported through your partners? Daniel, could you answer this one, please?
So today there is, the Android is not ready yet for the Verdin, but for other modules we have it, and typically we basically support what NXP provides. So when NXP does a drop for the reference carrier board for Android, we normally, in within about 6 weeks, we have the same available for our products. And I believe, and Amanda, correct me if I'm wrong here, it's going to be a 10, right? Android 4, the iMX8M Mini and Nano.
Android 10 releases are coming in the next 1 to 2 quarters for the 8M Mini and the 8M Nano. And then, you know, future Android will be, schedules will be provided once we have those releases available to us. But Android 10 will be released over the next 2 quarters for the 8M Mini and the 8M Nano.
Thank you, Amanda. The next question is, what's the timeline for Verdin at GOM6 Chapato? Daniel, can you take this one?
So it's currently in a closed beta. But it should go public in the next weeks. I don't have exact ETA about weeks, and we will definitely put out the press release to let you know about that, or you can get in touch with our sales and we will let you know as soon as it's online.
Thank you. And the next question, does the 8M Nano really only have one USB port? Isn't this also used for USB boot? Yes, this is a good question. So the iMX8M Nano has one USB OTG port, and the iMX8M Mini has one USB OTG and one USB 2.0 host port too. I'm not sure if you would like to add anything here, Amanda.
No, nothing to add at this point.
Okay, thank you. The next one, are you supporting PyQt for iMX8? Daniel, can you answer this one?
Yes, so in Torizon, we work very close with Qt to integrate with the Qt tool. So that's still something working on, but we already have demos how you can use PyQt on Torizon. So that's important, yes.
Thank you. I think the next one is also better suited for you. Do you have code generators for high-level APIs for configuring the peripherals?
Not directly, but that's something in work. So you saw, or you may be familiar or maybe not, with a tool called a pinout design tool from Toradex. So it allows you to configure the muxing of the module. And it allows you also to check for compatibility between module if you don't adhere to the standard muxing. So if you need, I mean, what Simon showed with the pinout, this is really the Verdin standard pinout, but the iMX8M Mini Nano and basically all application processors, they allow heavy muxing, and you can use that tool to mux and check if you're still compatible. And this does provide an API. And we are currently working on a tool which uses that API to create a device tree for your tool. So you can do it fully automatically. And currently, you have to manually edit the device tree file to basically configure your peripherals.
Thank you, Daniel. the next one. For thermal management, do you implement a shield can over the module? So this is a good question. And I would also like to point out a few things here. So as I said before, Verdin is prepared for thermal solutions. The base idea around that is that Verdin modules are cooled passively. And we prepared multiple thermal solutions for Verdin. So there will be thermal solutions supporting different use cases, from the very simple and easy to apply ones up to the industrial use cases where you basically have a heat sink covering the whole surface of the module, which you can screw down and you can shock and vibration proof, including the thermal solution too. So as I said before, on Verdin family, we will feature modules up to 5 watts TDP. And with these thermal solutions, we could operate safely in reasonably high environmental temperatures too. So the next question, when will the DSI display be available? Daniel, could you take this one?
Yes, so also here, unfortunately, no ETA, so we're looking at it. It's a little bit newer, so we wanna have something which is kind of industrial fit, so we don't have a size or an exact ETA available. But what we can say is that currently all the development carrier boards, they ship with a HDMI adapter, so you have a convenient way to get started. And so DSI displays from Toradex is something upcoming.
Thank you. The next question is, we have a robotic app. Do you have a system module? So it would be nice to know a little bit more about the requirements. But if you have anything in mind, Daniel, a particular module which you could recommend at this point, please feel free.
Yeah, I mean, I can just say robotic application is really very typical. We count that under industrial automation typically, and we have many, many customers. So we have robots with camera, then of course the higher performance modules are nice. We also have this M4 core or M7 core, which really allows you to offload real-time tasks. So if you have motion control system, even multiple access complex motion control, you need real-time. This is possible. If you have more like an industrial big robot one, we support EtherCAT, which is a common way to control robotic systems. So it really depends, as Simon said, a little bit on your application, but our modules are really designed to support a robot. So that's a very common use case.
Thank you, Daniel. And the next question, how is your support for Python on embedded Linux instead of Torizon? Daniel, I would also direct this one to you.
Yes, so actually Torizon is just the OS. So it's basically just a Linux OS, which is just optimized for the ease of use. And then Torizon comes with integration into some IDEs. This includes Visual Studio and Visual Studio Code. And for Visual Studio Code, we have basically ready to go a plugin which really connects it, and then you can use Python and you can debug Python, set breakpoints and do all these things on the device, a similar way like you would just run it on your computer. And all the abstraction, how to download the file, how to set up the debug connectivity and all that is taken care. So this is actually a very nice experience to use Python with Torizon.
Thank you. The next question, is DVFS supported on the modules? So as far as I know, yes, but Daniel, if I'm wrong, please feel free. Comment.
Yeah, the DVF, for people don't know, that's a dynamic voltage and frequency switching. So it's really optimizing the power consumption to the current workload. And that's something we definitely support. It works out of the box in a default mode, so it will just try to optimize it. But if you have real time or special requirements, you also can change that or set it to a frequency, or you take manual control over that. Yeah, that's important.
Thank you, Daniel. I'm looking at the list. I think we covered most of the questions, and also our time is up. Daniel or Amanda, if you would like to add anything, please feel free.
I would just say if there are continued questions, we do have on the specific product features for the SoC, we do have the iMX community, and we have our nxp.com website, and obviously, you know, Toradex has their website as well, where you can find further information and post questions.
Thank you, Amanda. So, in case there are any additional questions, then we will get back to everyone. Thanks everyone for joining today. Thank you very much for NXP and for Amanda for talking about the NXP iMX8M Mini and Nano system on chips. I hope to see you everyone in our upcoming webinars. I wish you a nice day. Take care. Bye.
Thanks everybody. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye everyone.